Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. This is Legislative Report. The question of autism, autism spectrum disorder, is one on many people's minds these days as a question of how do we take care of people with it, how do we pay for that, how do we define it, and the use of the word spectrum gives us a hint that it's not just one thing. I know that several decades ago, when I was part of a local community chest that did interviews with each of the applicants every year, had to go to a school for teaching those with autism, in fact, profound autism, and had to come back to define it, to explain it, to discuss the needs. And I know that I have been following this ever since because the spectrum itself has become better identified, but unfortunately not treatment better identified. Today we have joining with us is Janine Kruiswijk, who is the Executive Director of the Autism Society of Greater Capital Region. And I thought if we could explore a little bit with you some of the issues that there are out there, how does one go about identifying autism, it would be like instructive to the people tuning in.
Sure,
so Janine,
pleasure.
Thank you for coming by and saying hello.
Thank you for having me.
What would you say we view autism as now? What are the symptoms, the characteristics?
I think it's important to know that we consider it a developmental disability, not a mental health issue. And you know, the symptomology for kids can be quite wide-ranging. We do call it a spectrum disorder because we have individuals who are mildly affected, those that we know with Asperger's or PDD-NOS. And then
you gotta tell us what.
Back up and tell you what PDD-NOS. That is pervasive developmental disorder, not otherwise specified. And so we're looking at individuals who may have complete intact cognitive abilities, with some of the symptomology of autism, all the way to individuals who have, you know, somewhat impaired cognitive to severely impaired cognitive abilities, who are nonverbal, who will require lifetime care, who will not live independently. So the spectrum disorder really does range from very mildly affected to those who really are going to require quite a good deal of care and planning in order for them to have successful lives in our communities.
Who typically identifies a child as having a disorder?
That's depending. We would like for it to be that it is the pediatrician before the child is age 3. And we know that there are signs of autism today. We can see them at around age 18 months. But for some individuals, we have people who walk into our offices who are in their 50s and 60s who have recently been diagnosed, usually with Asperger's syndrome. So they grew up without a diagnosis with, you know, a certain amount of struggle. And as the communities got better educated on what those symptoms look like and what they were able to get an appropriate diagnosis, again, 40s, 50s, 60s. And so it's very interesting to talk to somebody who is first getting their diagnosis at that age.
It must be a little scary, but it also points out that this can be part of the population without us even knowing about
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. We have a large you know, proponent of individuals with autism who really have gone undiagnosed. They're married, they work, they are probably our friends and neighbors. In hindsight, when we hear the diagnosis, we can often go, oh yes. You know, we recognize
it clearly. What would be some of the symptoms for someone, especially someone where it's not very obvious? Because I remember going when I was a young man doing this interviewing. I went to a school that was dealing with a very profoundly disturbed, and it took a lot of intense work to try to draw people out. Although, interestingly, I went back to that school, now vastly expanded, right in Syosset in Nassau County, and they, as I went through the school, it was no longer just the profoundly disturbed. It was
Correct.
Children with very mild cases.
Yes, and this is exactly what we're seeing. We do still have, of course, the profound population, which are easier to identify when they're younger because the symptoms are very profound. We may see lack of eye contact. They may or may not be verbal, but the communication is always skewed. And social communication in particular is usually impacted. So we look at this as really a communication issue, sometimes a cognitive issue for those individuals who are more significantly affected. And what you may see in some of the individuals who are more mildly affected is a social awkwardness or a social Just a sort of, I'm trying to describe with words, their ability to interpret social communication is just a little bit off. So we may see an individual who doesn't maintain appropriate eye contact, although we may see people who do maintain eye contact, but it may be a little bit of a different eye contact.
So it's a very judgmental thing that people have to be very aware of.
It is. There is no blood test, there's no definitive physical test that you can take that says, ah, you have autism. We're still working on that, looking at the genetic components, looking at the familial components of this. We have families that have, generational autism. I am one of those families. I have it in an uncle, a brother, a child, and a couple of nephews, it looks like. So we see it through the males in our generation. We're also looking at women being diagnosed much more frequently. We thought that the statistics were one woman to every four boys who were being diagnosed, but they're saying that there may be a change in that, that most of our testing was normed on males. And so we're also taking a different look at what autism looks like in females.
So it's like many of our clinical trials have the same type of skewing.
Yeah. So we're getting better at our clinical diagnosis, which really accounts for some of the numbers. But the rise that we're seeing in autism, 1 in 110 children, does not explain or is not explained by the better clinical and diagnostic testing that we have today. We don't know exactly what's causing the rise, but we're seeing a pretty predominant rise. It's the fastest growing developmental disability today. And if you think about 1 in 110 kids being diagnosed today, now think about the forward impact of how many adults we're going to have. Some will be able to live quite independently, but will need assistance in the community. Some are going to need full out, pretty good support that is 24/7. So we really have to look at a range of opportunities and support systems for these individuals and their families, A, so that they can maintain in their own communities as much as is possible, and B, for those who are not able to do that, that we have the appropriate supports in place for them as they age.
And people have been looking for whether there's drugs that you can use to help temper what's going on, and then some. There was also a longer study that about one of the substances that looked like it might actually be a cure, but I don't think that the tests have proven that to be the case.
To date, they don't have a cure or a 100% definitive cause of autism. We've had a lot of suspicion and supposition in terms of what might be some of the cause. Well, you may have heard that some are pretty strongly footed that they think that it was either vaccines or chemicals within our environment. But the science, which is still working terribly hard to figure this out, has not really come up with a definitive cause. They're looking at genetics. They're looking at environmental toxins. And they really need to keep that research up. So we don't know whether we're looking at several routes to autism. So we have, maybe some genetically fragile individuals who, the tipping scale comes. Could that be environmental toxins? Perhaps. Could it be a vaccine? Science says no, but they need to keep looking because they don't have the answer yet.
Yeah.
And for those of us who may have genetic causes, they're starting to do some really fantastic work with looking at schizophrenia, autism, Tourette syndrome.
Overlaps with
all of the overlappings, correct. And trying to figure out, is there a genetic answer for this? Can they find something? Is there a particular gene? So they're still in the really exploratory phase of trying to figure out what is the root cause of this. And we'll never have, quote, a cure, until we get to that point.
When I was reading about, Watson and Crick and the DNA, and I thought at the beginning, well, you just have to identify the RNA and the DNA. And then, as it quickly realized, that the proteins themselves have to be interpreted. And
correct.
The proteins look like clouds in the sky folded over themselves.
Yes.
And the computing power necessary to decipher what's going on is just incredible. I call
it the biggest
frontier we have
in
our life today.
Yes, I think we're going to find incredible information. But on the other hand, when people talk about a cure for autism, we have to be very careful when we say that, because we have some very incredible people who we suspect were on the autism spectrum, such as Albert Einstein.
Really?
And so do we really want to cure that brilliance? What we may be looking at is, neurodiversity. Are we looking at, a different way of thinking, a different way of being? You know, and many of the adults with Asperger's and higher functioning autism will say, I don't want to be cured. There is nothing here to cure.
I read a letter to the editor about one of the books in the New York Times Book Review, and they were talking about, what do you mean saying some of the people in our math department at a very prestigious university have Asperger's? I think all of them do.
Yes.
And just because it takes that type of genius to be proficient.
It can take that type of genius. One of the stigmas and stereotypes that we want to be careful of is, you know, when you are talking about an individual with autism, although we may see some very high intellectual thinking, we want to be careful that we don't perpetuate the stereotype that everyone who has autism or Asperger's is a genius.
Going to the other end of the spectrum, there are children living within their own mind and not being able to communicate out,
correct,
and yet just for their own survival, because they're otherwise healthy, they need to have some type of communication skills.
Communication is huge. You know, when you're working with an individual who's nonverbal, or your family member who's got a child who's nonverbal and can't tell you when they're ill, or what their day was like. You know, we send our kids out to school and to different work scenarios, and these kids can't come back and tell us, or adults, it's not just kids, it's adults as well, they can't tell us what their day was like. So we put a lot of trust into the system that's out there that, you know, our children and our adults' days will be well-filled, well-cared for, you know, and that we have the appropriate supports and services and the appropriate people in place, you know, who will keep our loved ones safe and will provide, you know, what's appropriate and with dignity.
How the system? What would you describe the system as? It's early intervention?
When the kids are coming up young, we'll often see early intervention, which is the zero to three age. Then they get into special education, which is 3 to 5, which is our preschool system, and then we get into our school age system. Kids can get a lot of services within those years. We have a really at-risk population who comes out of school, and then we have to transition them over to adult services. And again, the spectrum is so wide. Some will come out and go into day services through OPWDD or through some of their vendors. And OPWDD is the Office of Persons with Developmental Disabilities. So they are the state organization that funnels through and takes care of our Medicaid waiver program for developmental disabilities. Some of our higher functioning folks go into the OMH system, because what you're really looking at are the behavioral aspects of the disorder. Even though it's a developmental disability, you've got the behavioral aspects of it. So we see them in the OMH system, which is Office of Mental Health. We also, unfortunately, can see them in the justice system or in OASIS, which is substance abuse. So we really want to make sure that we get those interventions in there early. And we know that we can reduce the cost of lifetime care by 2/3 if we provide intensive early treatment to these kids.
We face this whenever people are asking us to cut back on early intervention. And you just know that for every ailment or condition that you can lessen or actually do away with, you've saved millions of dollars down the road.
Absolutely. We're looking at a cost today of approximately $90 billion. You know, and that's school care, lifetime care, diagnosis, the benefit programs. If we don't provide early intervention, you know, we could really see an increase to $200 to $400 billion is what they're estimating. So early intervention, we know, is key for these kids in order to become the most functioning, independent adults that they possibly can be. And when you think about saving 2/3 of the lifetime care and cost for an individual just by early intervention, It's an easy supposition to make.
Well, I said to you before, we have a number of schools in my district who have just, because they, when we had surplus regular schools or they had some land available, and we're very intensively working on all of that. And sometimes, many times, it turns out children go to the schools for a while and then just go back mainstream.
Go back to their district, correct.
It's really very interesting.
And that's best case scenario, isn't it?
Oh, we hope. But we still have these large hurdles to overcome. And I'm glad you've shared your insights, Janine, with us.
Well, thank you.
I thank you very much for tuning in. We've run out of time. I'm Senator Kemp Hannon.